At the time Proctors was built, a theater pipe organ was an integral part of most every major movie palace. It provided the background music during arrival and intermissions, sound effects for silent films, and accompaniment for vaudeville shows and stage productions. The installation of a three-manual, 18-rank Wurlitzer theater organ represented a significant step towards the restoration of Proctors Theater to its original grandeur.
There's not that many venues remaining in around New York State that still have functioning theater pipe organs. That makes Proctors Theater somewhat unique. We share that position with places like Radio City Music Hall and the Capitol Theater in Utica, the Shea Theater in Buffalo, and altogether maybe 10 installations that are still functioning in New York State.
The organ was how bands were replaced. And a theater organ versus a church organ had bells and whistles and drums and all this stuff because they were like calliopes. They were one-man orchestras. And they were a way to help the movie theater operator, movie theater and live theater operator, keep the entertainment going more affordably than having a pit with 25 musicians in it.
The story begins back in the late 1920s, just as the heyday of the silent motion picture was ending. Despite the clumsiness of the Vitaphone system, which utilized 33 1/3 RPM records synchronized with film motion, Al Jolson's 1927 release of The Jazz Singer was symbolic of an era that ended abruptly. Within the few years following the film's release, movie theaters across the country were quickly becoming wired for sound. Obviously no longer a fad, theaters quickly fired their orchestras and dramatically reduced their stage crews as the mighty pipe organs that had enhanced the moods depicted on the screen were suddenly found to be superfluous.
Synced sound and the talkies really put an end to the theatrical organ as a mainstay part of what a building like this did.
Most of the 7,000 instruments built to accompany silent films eventually became the unwilling victims of an unhappy fate. Many of the unlucky ones went down with the theaters themselves, as they too became the victims of changing times, changing tastes, or changing neighborhoods. Goldie was built by the Wurlitzer Company in North Tonawanda, New York, which dominated the theater organ scene, selling some 2,300 organs between 1914 and 1942. The organ was named Goldie due to its original all-gold finish and purchased from Claude Newman in Minneapolis, thanks to the success of the Capital Fund Drive and generous contributions from the Golub family and the Golub Foundation. The organ was delivered to Proctors in 1983. The installation process was long and involved, and would have been impossible without the countless hours of volunteer work by members of the American Theater Organ Society like Frank Hackett and Dick Calderwood.
Dick worked quite a bit on the console renovation yep. project that occurred in the early part of the 2000 decade. And what we did was to replace all of those old pneumatic actions inside of the console with this electronically controlled direct electric action. In the original configuration, these consoles had to be connected to an air supply, which meant that they were tethered to the pipe organ air supply system by a big 4-inch diameter airline. And that limited the mobility of the console. It pretty much always had to sit in the same spot because of that airline. So by eliminating the pneumatic system and going to direct electric, we are now tethered by only electrical wires, which can be made of various lengths so that we're able to move the console all over.
The improvements to Goldie make the organ easier to play and more capable than ever before.
So what we did was to rebuild the entire stop rail, replacing each of those actions with a direct electric electromagnet type action, which is virtually maintenance-free and has a life expectancy measured in many decades. the sound of a pipe organ is produced by pipes. In each note of each rank or particular sound of pipe requires a pipe.
The pipes are located near the ceiling on each side of the auditorium. They play at a constant volume, and they're controlled by a series of shutters which are opened and closed with the foot pedals on the console. The further you push the pedal down, the more shades open, makes them more volume.
Conversion to digital was quite an undertaking, as you said, and probably took 2 years, I think. That was when I first got here. That was a big, big endeavor. Then when they first got it out, it didn't work and had to be taken apart again. And then there was rain damage during the renovations, and so a fair amount of the bells and whistles and some pipes were damaged and bellows were damaged.
And then we had to check it out and get it all working properly. And that turned out to be much more difficult than we expected, but I think we're finally there now.
Well, now that she's modern, you know, people get to record on MIDI. So if someone does a concert, they can walk away with a digital version of a piano roll, can come back and replay that exact same concert from the MIDI. So that's kind of interesting. So when they upgraded it, they brought it right up to the 21st century.